Hey everyone, sorry for the delay. Today we'll be talking about some of the TI's latest PSR flyback offerings. And the scope of today's presentation is to show that, you know, with these newer devices, achieving isolation is quite simple, yet, you know, you can still get high performance, and that's what I'm trying to highlight in this first title slide here. Before I get into the meat of this presentation, I'd like to introduce myself real quickly. My name is Marshall Beck. I'm in the applications team, part of the analog power products division of Texas Instruments. And I support, you know, mainly buck type topologies, as well as some isolated solutions in TI's wide VN division. Next slide, please. So, here are some of the topics that I like to go over today. So first, I like to highlight the need for isolation in industrial applications. And the main topology that we'll be covering today for these types of industrial applications that need isolation would be the PSR flyback. I'll get into, you know, PSR flyback versus the conventional case, pros and cons. And from there, do some, you know, just gloss over the general control and operation of this device and highlight some of the TI offerings for this device family, this PSR flyback family. And after that, you know, I mentioned that, you know, I view this as a simple isolated solution. I'll try and demonstrate that with, you know, all the tools that TI has to offer in regards to that, which range from Webbench to, you know, a design calculator tool. And I'll be highlighting specifically, you know, some of the design calculator tools that we're quite proud of for this device family. And lastly, you know, I'll show some supporting content on how to design the PSR flyback. And those will include some articles and some reference designs. And throughout this presentation, feel free to put questions in the chat box and someone will get back to you. I'm not sure, you know, at the end if we'll have time to discuss those questions, but I'll do my best. All right, next slide, please. So, you know, we see industrial applications needing isolation in many different types of, you know, configurations or, you know, power trees. So for example, you have say 24 volt rectified DC input with some input fluctuation. You know, TI is targeting these types of applications with some PSR flyback offerings that would cover this input voltage range for this industrial application, 24 volt DC, or say the power over Ethernet type application. And, you know, these applications which range from, you know, we see a lot of our customers wanting isolation, you know, say PLC, solar application, and IP phone. Next slide, please. So why is isolation needed? Here's a few things that we see isolation be needed for based on our customers' experiences. You may have different or have more knowledge than us or have different applications, but we see a need for, you know, safety. You know, maybe an application's given safety standard. And, you know, these would be to prevent any sort of line surge, you know, by having isolation implemented into your system. In addition to that, there's a need for, say, signal integrity or to avoid noise being generated in the systems, which could negatively affect, say, a communication protocol such as RS-232, or, you know, say, for sensing, you know, different voltages or small currents, which would then be translated to an ADC, and that could, you know, affect the effective number of bits, say. And lastly, this isn't a comprehensive list, but the last one we see being very popular where isolation is needed would be for inversion, level shifting, and generating multiple rails. And this would be more that you want to simplify your power tree and actually make sense from a cost, a size, and a complexity standpoint to implement a transformer-based type isolated supply where you can have multiple windings to generate these different power domains, whether being of opposite polarity or of opposite polarity in different magnitudes. You have a lot of flexibility there. Next slide, please. So diving deeper real quickly into some of those examples I mentioned, I was talking about noise integrity or the signal integrity issues. And I mentioned specifically, communication protocol like RS-232, where, some of these applications we see, the issue of noise where, the TX, the transceiver or the transmitter is much far away from the receiver. And, you have this long cable, which could possibly pick up some noise, which can affect the communication protocol with it being relatively fast sometimes. And in some of these low power designs, it can't manage this type of noise that could be generated on the signal or the ground path. Here's something that we often recommend doing. I don't have all the details on this, but this is the general idea. It's creating an isolation layer between the transmitter and the receiver to eliminate such issue and to avoid any communication issues there. Next slide, please. So I was also talking about, simplifying the power tree. So we see, the applications in which you might need a positive and negative rail, possibly of the same magnitude and just different polarity, or, two separate positive supplies. For example, in the, a gate driver application, possibly. And, it might make sense from a system perspective in terms of cost and solution size and design complexity to, have a transformer-based power supply where you can have multiple windings to achieve these different power rails, quite simply, as you'll see in our design section of this presentation for the PSR flyback. Next slide, please. So here's a nice graphic, I believe, of comparing the different flyback topologies, well, some of them, specifically the feedback scheme for these topologies. So I have these ones over to the left, which I call the conventional case, where, the feedback is sent via, in the leftmost one, through an auxiliary winding. You can call it a sense winding. And we see this as increasing the complexity of the magnetics, possibly limiting the amount of transformers you can select from that are in your library, or requiring a custom transformer to be made. In addition to that, it'll increase the size. And in the middle, there's similar constraints here, maybe a little bit more. And this would be the optocoupler feedback solution, where you have an optocoupler, which creates the isolation between the the primary and secondary, or the isolation and isolated and the non-isolated side of the power supply design, which is good. But there's some concerns with reliability here. We see our customers complaining about. In addition to that, you got to design the compensation, which can create issues there in terms of achieving first pass success in your power supply design, And lastly, of course, as there's more components, the size increases. And lastly, on the far right is the topology that I'll be covering today in more detail, and that's the boxless PSR flyback, where the output air or the feedback information is translated from the output back onto the input based on the reflected voltage back on the primary. And you'll see in our sampling scheme, this allows for very tight output regulation, even across temperature. And the corresponding output voltage, I'll just mention real quickly, is set by these two small resistors, RFB and RSET. So, achieving this tight output regulation is quite easily. In addition to that, this topology offers operation in DCM or boundary mode conduction or boundary conduction mode. And what this enables is a very high efficiency figure as, one, the mag current is always being reset to zero in every cycle to ensure maximum output transfer to the load in each cycle. In addition to that, you're not dealing with any reverse recovery of the rectifier diode on the outputs as the current decays to zero, and then in the subsequent turn on of the power FET in the next cycle, there'll be current in that diode as well. That the power FET will also turn on with zero current, so it's a zero current switching type device. So the switching losses can be reduced a little bit with that type of control scheme, and that enables a higher efficiency figure. Next slide, please. So here's the PSR flyback that I'm talking about here. And in this slide, I'm highlighting one of the relatively recently released devices TI has. I'll be showing another one in the subsequent slide, but here's, the nice, what I feel is a very small schematic for this device to generate a positive and negative rail, say for, an op amp application, say. And as you can see here, I mentioned that the output voltage set by the RFB and RSET resistors. So there's no opto coupler, there's no auxiliary winding here. The output voltage is sensed through the primary winding with respect to VN, and I have that in more detail over to the right. So how is the output voltage sensed in this device? I mentioned that in this device that there's voltage sensing done when the current through the rectifier diode is at zero current. And that might be hard to see here, but as you can see, we got on the top part of this oscilloscope plot, the green, and this would be the current flowing through the rectifier diode, and it's decaying towards zero. And this is while the power FET is on. And right at what we call the knee, when the switch node starts to fall, is at the point in which we sense this current. That's where the current through this diode is zero. So at this point, when you're trying to, determine whatever resistors, to use, we're able to treat the offset as a constant, that diode drop, which is an offset, as a constant. It won't vary as the current through that diode is zero, so you can treat it as a constant. And in turn, it allows for a simple calculation of the resistors you just use to set the output voltage. In addition to that, you may think that, we have devices which have some temperature coefficient, and, we have the the diode in series with the output, which is setting the, you know, the output as it's being, you know, measured as the reflected voltage on the primary, and that's how the, you know, the device corrects for any error on the output. So I'll go into more detail in a subsequent slide, but in addition to, you know, the sensing on the primary, we also sense for any temperature variance that can be expected by that diode, as we have a TC pin in many of our devices, which compensate for the temperature variance, which corresponds to any diode drop variance, which would then impact the output voltage. And in the next slides, you'll see that, you know, across temperature, across the ambient rating of this device, the output regulation is quite good. Next slide, please. So TI is working towards developing a pretty comprehensive portfolio that covers many of these industrial applications. As you can see, here's a few devices, you know, not a comprehensive list that TI offers that are PSR flybacks, specifically flyback inverters. So the power FET is integrated onto the die into the package of the device. And they have a input voltage range that specifically covers, you know, the industrial applications that we're trying to service, whether that be, you know, that power over Ethernet or a, you know, standard 24 volt input with that corresponding input fluctuation. In addition to that, you can see that we're trying to develop devices which cover a large load range. And for the given output voltage, turns ratio, and input voltage, you can see the corresponding max load current for the device's peak primary current limit on the column to the other side of that. Next slide, please. Here's one device I'd like to highlight. This is probably the most recent device that TI has released. That's a PSR flyback. And it's got some of the features that I've already talked about. I'll try to go over it a little bit quickly and recommend, if you're interested in this type of device, to, you know, reference, you know, some of the links I have in the subsequent slide that can show more detail regarding this device. So, you know, it's one of those line items that I showed in the earlier slide and has an input voltage range that covers many of the industrial applications TI is trying to cover, 4.5 volt to 42 volts with a power FET that has a higher rating to account for, you know, the reflected output voltage back on the primary, which, you know, the power FET would be then, you know, needing to support to be able to block that voltage. And also, you know, you can expect some mag inductance ring, and by having that power FET a little bit higher with some additional margin on top of the highest VIN plus the rectified reflected voltage, we have some additional margin to account for the mag inductance ring that you can most definitely expect. And that will enable you to, you know, possibly do away with the clamp circuit D1, D2, or at the very least, you know, not need to, you know, size it as aggressively. Furthermore, you know, it's got this TC pin that I mentioned earlier on, which compensates for any temperature coefficient that you can expect with that rectifier diode that could translate to some output offset as you look across the operating condition of the device. And in addition to that, you know, again, we have the boundary conduction mode with this device to ensure the highest efficiency. And it's also got a DCM mode of operation and also the FF mode of operation, which I didn't completely cover in the previous slide, but it enables also, you know, we get high efficiency at the highest load turn due to boundary conduction mode, and we get very good light load efficiency with FF mode, which you can read more on the product data sheet, but in general, it just, you know, we fold back the frequency to reduce the switching losses to get the high either IQ figure or light load efficiency. And, you know, this device is targeted for, you know, many of these factory automation and industrial applications. And you'll see that, you know, some of these, you know, reliability of this device is quite good with the package. And this is the package here, you know, the 4x4 WSON. And it's, it can be visually inspected. Next slide, please. Here are some of the quick performance metrics I'd like to highlight for this device, some of which I've already mentioned. So firstly, you know, this device, not only, you know, the bomb count is small due to, you know, the how the feedback, you know, information is translated from the output back on to the non-isolated side to, you know, the reflected output voltage on the primary. You know, we're able to achieve a very small solution size, as you can see in the middle picture. In addition to that, we operate, or we can operate at a modest switching frequency up to 350 kilohertz for this device. So the corresponding magnetic, as you can see, is pretty small for this power rating. And not only does this switching frequency, which is, you know, this modest switching frequency, enable small magnetics, it also enables, you know, reasonable transient performance, as you can see in the leftmost figure, where we have a low transient with very little output, you know, perturbation for this given low transient. I mentioned, you know, this device has a good efficiency figure, both light load and at full load. Given for full load, you know, full load, I'm talking to the far right, this efficiency plot at the right hand of the screen. We have boundary conduction mode, and that enables maximum output transfer to the load, as we have the rectifier diode's current hit zero in each cycle, and hit zero before the subsequent turn on of the power FET to ensure no reverse recovery through the diode, as well as zero current switching of the power FET. So we're able to reduce the switching losses, which would be higher at the fuller loads where the device is operating at max frequency. And at light load, you know, I mentioned we're able to get a relatively high efficiency figure as the default switching frequency, 350 kilohertz or so, would be folded back to enable lower switching losses at light load, where not much output power is needed. So switching losses are the predominant loss within the device. So by folding back the switching frequency, we're able to get a high efficiency figure, relatively speaking. In the earlier slide, I was showing a load regulation curve, which just showed, you know, the typical load regulation at an ambient temperature of 25 degrees C. Here I'm showing load regulation across temperature. And why is that? I'm trying to show that the temperature coefficient of the rectifier diode, and, you know, doesn't play a role in the output regulation of the device. And that's due, in fact, due to the temperature compensation pin that this device offers, which will counteract whatever the temperature coefficient of that diode is, and that corresponding delta on the voltage drop across that diode. And that's demonstrated by the less than 1.7 variance from the whole operating, the whole ambient operation range of this device, negative 40 degrees C to 125 degrees C. We're continuing to see our customers need, you know, more, need to meet more stringent EMC standards. And, you know, for these devices, these PSR flyback devices, before release to market, we're ensuring that they have a very low noise figure, and we're actually demonstrating that in the data sheet now. And here's a plot that I captured in which, you know, we're doing a EMC scan, and, you know, this EMC scan is with CISPR 25 class 5 limits, which is, it's an automotive standard, but it's quite stringent. And for a lot of these EMC standards, you can expect only differential filtering being needed to achieve even the most stringent standards at full load current. Next slide, please. I was talking about, you know, what I viewed as a simple design flow for this device. And here's a quick highlight of that, and I'll go into more detail in the subsequent slide. But this is how I view the design flow going. So first, you know, starting from left and going to the right. Now, say you have a general block diagram of your application, and you've identified a need for isolation. You know, maybe it's one of those items I mentioned earlier, such as, you know, you need to generate a positive and negative rail for an op amp, and it, by having an isolated supply, you know, it'll simplify the power tree. And then you do a parametric search on TI.com. You know, you look through our devices, and then you come up with a device. Maybe it's this LM25183 or 4 device, you know, TI's most recently released PSR Flyback. And you go to the product folder, and I'm going to the right now, and you see, you know, we got all these different things. We, for example, we got P-Spice for TI. You know, we have these spice models, which you can look at transient plots, as well as you can look at, you know, stability. Furthermore, we got WebEdge. You can do the component calculation, and you can look at the corresponding BOM. My favorite is these design tools. These are something that I work on, and also other applications engineers work on. So they're quite refined, and these are actually what we use to do our reference designs. And essentially what they do is you have, and I'll show this more in a subsequent slide, you know, you input the power conditions, and rather than going through the 40 plus hand calculations to determine the components, you know, you come up with the components just by entering in those, you know, 5 or 6 line items. And that's what's being shown here. So this is how the design calculator, this is how I use it. And it's, so we have a design calculator that actually encompasses the whole PSR flyback family. And, you know, you select based on the parametric search and the device that meets your application requirements, you select the device. And from there, you enter in your corresponding application power conditions. In this case, I'm selecting a dual output power supply. And from there, you take a look at the available flybacks that you have in your library. And you take a look at the data sheet, and you enter in the corresponding spec, and you see if that spec meets the requirements for your application. And, you know, how you do that is you see no red boxes. If not, you know, we have an output that says, you know, why is this box red and how to correct it. And from there, you know, assuming that the first two work good, you know, there's no red boxes based on your device selection and the corresponding power conditions, and the selected flyback is sufficient for your application, the flyback transformer, you come up with this nice BOM. And, you know, you can see the corresponding component values, and we even, you know, print the corresponding case sizes of these components, given the required power rating of these devices. And then you can, you know, guesstimate the corresponding solution size. And lastly, given all those things, you can evaluate the performance. You can take a look at the switching frequency with various loading condition. And also you can look at the efficiency of the device to then determine the corresponding power loss of the device and how much it'll heat up. Next slide, please. So we're trying to take it a step further, and we're trying to, you know, make these reference designs which target a lot of the applications, you know, we see that these PSR flybacks go into, and try and, you know, allow for a plug and play type solution. Here's some examples. You know, we're definitely open to more ideas, and I recommend, you know, if there's reference designs you want to see, you know, you can communicate with the TI team, or, you know, make some posting on E2E and we could take a look into it. But the idea is, you know, we come up with a reference design, we prove it out, and then we publish it along with the design file. So it's, you know, like I said, a plug and play solution. And here's some automotive application reference design, such as, you know, the IGBT gate driver, or the, you know, the SICK gate driver. In addition to that, we have a PLC design in the bottom right hand corner, and that's an analog input module reference design. Next slide, please. I mentioned that we have quite a few references in addition to the design calculator. Here are some that I'd like to highlight in this slide. You know, we have a user guide that's done for our EVM. It has a lot of knowledge that we've learned throughout the years contained that EVM user guide regarding device operation, layouts, and schematic entry, and, you know, lessons learned in terms of layout and schematic entry. In addition to that, you know, we talk about some of those applications we see, you know, our devices going into, and we talk about how our devices, our PSR flybacks, enable us to fulfill those application requirements. For example, in the PLC or in, you know, MHEV type application where isolation is needed. And lastly, you know, this list is continuing to evolve, and we're covering, you know, general power pain points such as EMI issues and thermal concerns in our power supply designs. And the lower two items covered those items. Next slide, please. And in conclusion, you know, I mentioned some of the, you know, the typical places where we see isolation be needed. For example, that could be simplifying the power tree in these signal conditioning type applications. They're trying to avoid noise and it interrupting the performance of your application, such as in applications that include communication protocols, which are relatively fast in speed or low in power, and sensor applications where you need to ensure accurate ADC conversion of that sensed voltage or current, maybe in a 4 to 20 milliamp loop. And then in gate driver applications, where a isolated gate bias supply is needed. We find for, you know, these applications as well as others, the PSR flyback is a preferred solution for these due to its relatively low cost. You know, we don't have to have any complicated feedback voltage sensing such as an optocoupler design or an auxiliary winding with a magnetic. You know, as I try to highlight, there's no strenuous design needed. You know, we have many tools, including our comprehensive design calculator that walks you through all the calculations just by entering in those cells of that Excel sheet and telling you, you know, why maybe this doesn't work and what you need to do to change it. And it shares you the corresponding performance metrics of the device. And the simple BOM and the simple design, you know, it doesn't come with sacrificing performance. As you can see, our load regulation with some of our IP enables very good load regulation and a very high efficiency figure across the load current of this device. Lastly, I'd like to urge you to take a look at some of those TI PSR flyback offerings that I showed in the earlier slide. You know, you can visit these slides at a later time and click on those links, and it'll take you to the product folder, and you can reference some of those, you know, the calculator tools and the articles that we've generated for this device. And in addition to that, some of the design resources that we have for these devices. That said, that concludes my presentation. And if there's any questions, feel free to post them in the chat. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Marshall. And thank you, everybody, for joining today. And we apologize for the technical difficulties at the beginning. But like Marshall said, you can find the slides and the recording to this webinar later today at www.ti.com/npu. And we hope to see you same time next week for the topic humidity sensors. Have a great week, everybody.